Welcome to you all who call upon the name of Christ. This is the night to remember. Remember his new covenant of broken bread and cup. Remember his arrest and trial. Remember his sinless hands which were spread wide in blessing, and then kneeled high on the cross to cancel our sins together. Remember this night and thank God for Jesus' presence with us.
My life, my all. Today's scripture reading is on John chapter 13, verse 1 to 5. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. Verse 12 to 17, when he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." Verses 34 to 35. "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." This is the word of the Lord.
Let us begin with a word of prayer. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, in the midst of this human control, in the midst of social distancing, which prevents us from meeting together physically as a congregation of your people, we thank you, Lord, that we can still meet together in a virtual manner to enjoy, to listen and be blessed by your word together. And for this, we give you thanks, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. The world knows what is Good Friday, so also Easter, but may not be so familiar with Maundy Thursday. What is this Maundy Thursday? Put simply, Maundy Thursday is the day before Good Friday when our Lord celebrated his final Passover meal with his disciples. It marks the final 3 days of Lent before Easter. The most significant events of this occasion was the washing of the disciples' feet, an acted out sermon of what love and humility means in this new commandment that Jesus gave, and also the institution of the Lord's Supper or Holy Communion. The disciples might not have fully comprehended the meaning of his actions on that fateful night. Nevertheless, Jesus commanded them to do the same. In the ancient church, Christians observed the Holy Week services of Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night as a continuous service and reenacting the final events of Jesus' life and death preceding the resurrection. In some churches, this enactment includes the agape meal, or love feast, which the Apostle Paul alluded in 1 Corinthians 11. The rite of feet washing, symbolic of this new commandment, the supper itself, and the reenactment of the journey from the upper room to the Mount of Olives and to the Garden of Gethsemane. This service was normally conducted with an air of solemnity because of the impending events of Good Friday, and silence permeates throughout the service. Lights are dim to give a sense of the sadness and gloom of the occasion. Maundy Thursday comes from the Latin word mandatum novum, meaning a new commandment. This new commandment was given by Jesus to his disciples as he washed their feet on the night of the Last Supper. A new commandment I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. What did Jesus mean when he said love one another? Exactly what does this word one another mean? Does it just refer to the exclusive group of 12 disciples? Or does it refer to the community of faith? Or do they include all the other people outside the church? Why is this commandment called the new commandment? To love one another is nothing new to the human race. Husbands love their wives. Wives love their husbands. Parents love their children. We love our siblings, our nuclear family, our extended family. We love our friends, especially those who have helped us along the way. We all know how to love. So what is so new about this new commandment, this new love? It is new because Jesus raised the bar of the love he demanded to a new level, even to love our enemies. By his life and teaching, Jesus lived out this love. In his encounter with the Samaritan woman, a non-Jew and a woman of questionable repute, in the parable of the Good Samaritan, Jesus taught that our love should extend across racial and religious barriers, to extend even to people whom we do not like or people who do not like us. Jesus interacted with people like tax collectors, whom the self-proclaimed holy men of the day, the Pharisees, despised as sinners. This new commandment, with its new standard of love, was demonstrated when Christ sacrificial gave his life for mankind on the cross, offering forgiveness and a new spiritual life to everyone, including to people who don't appear to deserve it, including his enemies. Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrated his love in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Luke 6:27, but I tell you who hear me, love your enemies, do good to those who hate. And again in Matthew 43, 44, you have heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemies. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Maundy Thursday, with its new commandment, poses a very challenging situation to Jesus' followers since that day. How can we live up to these extremely high standards, which, if we are all honest with ourselves, is humanly near impossible? How can we love those who have stabbed us in our back, figuratively and physically? People who destroy our careers, our future. People who have caused us so much harm, physically and emotionally, to ourselves and to our loved ones. The person who murdered your parents and your siblings. The wife who is abused, starved, and beaten on a daily basis. Must she still love that monster husband? The list goes on. Worse still, some of these atrocities are committed by people whom we look up to and put our trust in. It becomes even more hurtful when these are committed by people of a faith similar to ours. They not only betray us, they destroy us. Can we love such people? I offer no simplistic solution. Neither do I want to idealize or romanticize it, confessing that I am far away off the mark of this commandment that Jesus said on that first Maundy Thursday. In the above examples that I've cited, I've given a few concrete flesh and blood issues in our struggle to obey this new commandment. But that is what Jesus taught and the standard he set that all his followers are called to follow, to emulate. In obeying this new commandment, we also take cognizance of Jesus' teaching of justice, that there will be a counting of our actions that we dish out to other people. I do not believe that this commandment calls us to love indiscriminately, to love mindlessly, oozing up to anybody who crossed our path, even when we know of their dubious character. In Matthew 10:16, Jesus calls us to be shrewd as snakes and innocent as doves, simply because there are many wolves amongst the people that we deal with every day in our life. Having said that, I am not trying to dilute this new commandment. Rather, I want to affirm that this is what God expects of people who profess Him as Lord and Master. This new commandment awakens us and makes us aware how far short we have fallen when measured against God's standards. No wonder Isaiah cried out in Isaiah 64:6, all our righteous acts are like filthy rags when placed side by side with God's plumb line. At the same time, 1 John 4:7-8, the Apostle Paul warns us that those who do not love does not belong to God. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. And whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Friends, we know we have not loved our enemies. That's why at every Holy Communion service, we pray this prayer. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbor. And if I'm permitted to add, let alone our enemies. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Some of us may have gone a long way to forgive these people who have hurt us so deeply. Surrender that misery that they inflicted upon us to God, because we believe that vengeance belongs to God. The scars reminds us of what they did, but they can also move us to release forgiveness to such people. They can move us to pray for our tormentors that one day that these people may experience the love of God. Repent, and if applicable, restitution be made, like in the case of Zacchaeus in Luke 19, for the losses that we have suffered because of their actions. Of course, we also hope that one day there may be closure to all the pain and suffering that we have gone through while we are still on earth, however remote that may be. The next important thing in our Maundy service is the institution of the Lord's Supper, or what we normally call the Holy Communion. We are all very familiar with this sacrament because we partake of it every month. Therefore, let me very briefly summarize the significance of what this Holy Communion or the Lord's Supper signifies. One, the Lord's Supper is an ordinance of Christ. Jesus commanded his followers to repeat his action with this word: do this in remembrance of me. Secondly, it is a covenant meal. Jesus said, this is the blood of the covenant. Speaks of the sacrifice that enacts the restored relationship between the Lord and his people. To the disciples, the immediate consequence was the cross the very next day. To the believers over the centuries after the first Good Friday, it is a reminder that the perfect Lamb of God was sacrificed for the redemption of our sins. Hence, each time we come for communion, it should be a time of recommitment to follow in the footsteps of our Master. Third, the Lord's Supper is a communion or a participation in the life of Christ as represented by the bread and the cup, as seen in 1 Corinthians 10, 16 and 17. A communion not just for the individual worshipper, but for the corporate church. The one loaf symbolizes the unity of all believers. It is therefore also a time to examine our relationships and to seek forgiveness and reconciliation with each other before the Lord. Fourth, the Holy Communion is a proclamation of Christ's victory over sin, a representation of the redeeming event of Christ's death. Wherever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Fifthly, it is the Eucharist, the giving of thanks to the Lord for the gifts of life and salvation, as Jesus gave thanks over the bread and cup. While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take it, this is my body. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, and they all drank from it. 6. The Lord's Supper is a sacramental act in the sense of an outward symbol or a spiritual window through which a deeper reality may be realized. It is an outward and visible sign of an inward and invisible spiritual grace. When we participate in them with genuine faith and repentance, we receive and experience the blessings and grace of God. 7. And finally, the Holy Communion is a pointer to the future when the kingdom of God will come in his fullness. I tell you, Jesus said in Matthew 26, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I will drink it in my Father's house. It is a time where Christ will return to judge the world and to take us back to himself. Each time we celebrate or come for a Maundy Thursday service, the covenant between God and ourselves is renewed, and we are made ready for death and resurrection. While foot washing may not be optional, love is not optional. Jesus gave us this new commandment to love one another as he himself loved us. It is a commandment to love, not a suggestion to love. And the difference is obvious. But we cannot dispense love if we have pride in our lives. Pride must be replaced with humility, willing to treat others as we treat ourselves. Love your neighbor as yourself summarizes our relationship with our fellow man. Jesus demonstrated what humility entails when he stooped down to wash the disciples' feet. The epitome of humility is found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 to 8, where Jesus showed us not only the meaning of humility, but also the cost of humility. Jesus, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human form, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Dear friends, each time we partake of the bread and the wine, my hope and prayer is that it is not another routine, it is not another ritual. May we appreciate more of the love poured out at Calvary by living lives that truly speaks of the forgiveness and grace that we have received. May humility accompany every act of service we render to our fellow man. Amen. Shall we pray? Gracious God, your anointed one, on the night before he suffered, instituted the sacrament of his body and blood. Mercifully grant that we may receive it thankfully, in remembrance of Jesus Christ our Lord, who in these holy mysteries give us a pledge of eternal life. Amen. Thank you.
sacred head now wounded, with grief and shame weighed down, now scornfully surrounded with thorns, thy only crown. How pale thou art with anguish, with sore abuse and scorn. How does that visage languish, which once was bright as morn? What thou, my Lord, hast suffered, 'twas all for sinners' gain. Mine was the transgression, but thine the deadly pain. Lo, here Savior, 'tis I deserve thy place. Look on me with thy favor, vouchsafe to me thy grace.
Let us pray. This night is our calling to go into the world, scattered to the ends of the earth, to love as Christ loved and serve in the name of Christ. It is our calling to remember, even in our darkest hour, who we are. We remember that Christ is always with us, and remember that on this night, we were taught how to love. On this night, eternity begins and the fullness of God's reign begins to spill into our lives. So go into the world to give yourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, go into the world and love in the name of the one who loved you until the end. It all begins and ends and begins again
with love. And now let us receive the benediction. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and abide with you, now and forevermore. Amen.
Shine like the sun.